الحمد لله وحده والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده وبعد. My name is Tahir Wyatt. I'm from Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. I'm currently a PhD candidate at the Islamic University of Medina, awaiting my defense in comparative religion. I was born and raised in Philadelphia. From the second grade all the way to high school, I went to Philadelphia public schools. I was blessed to go to some of the better public schools in the city. So I went to J.R. Masterman for middle school, and for high school I went to Central. It was at Central High in 1993 that I accepted Islam. My father used to be a Christian youth minister, but when he got a bit older and it was time to go to college, he went to Philadelphia College of Bible. That is when he decided to leave Christianity. He studied some of the history of the Bible, its compilation, and he was no longer convinced that it was the Word of God. So he left Christianity. My mother was also raised as a Christian, not a strict Protestant, but she also left Christianity for a number of reasons. So I was not raised as a Christian, which was very different from the majority of my peers, whether they were classmates, neighbors, or otherwise. But I was raised, I would say, with a sense of justice. And that justice is important, that people should be treated equally, regardless of race or gender, ethnicity. Okay, I would say that the pivotal point in my life was probably 1991 or 1992, when I met Troy Carter, who is most famous for being Lady Gaga's manager. Troy at that time was a friend of a friend, and he was fresh off of a record deal with Jive Records, and he had a very good relationship with Will Smith and Jazzy Jeff. And so I looked at it as an opportunity. I was an aspiring artist, if I can use the term loosely. I was about 14 at that time, and so meeting Troy was a game changer for me in a lot of different ways. He kind of took me under his wing, told me about an idea that he had for a group. He wanted three guys and a girl, which was that was a bit abnormal at this time. So like I said, we're talking early 90s, 91, 92. I'm not exactly sure. The reason why it was a game changer for me, I would say, is because it basically, it filled up all of my time. There was no time to do anything other than go to school, make sure you get your work done, your homework, your projects, and so on and so forth, and practice. So we had rigorous daily practice as a group under the management of Troy Carter. And that was to prepare us for, you know, stage performances. So our daily routine consisted of exercise, vocal practice. I mean, just a whole lot of things. But the main thing was, like I said, it took up the lion's share of my time. So I didn't have time to get into a lot of things that other people would get into just hanging out on the streets. We were with Troy for over a year. We had a production deal. Back then, a production deal was basically you get $100,000 or $200,000 to produce a record. So you have to pay freelance musicians and things like that that will do the music for you. And this is the interesting point here, was that Troy gave me the responsibility of reaching out to a lot of these people that we would organize our meetings with. So one of them happened to be a Muslim. I didn't know it at the time. And we started talking about, you know, meeting up. So we need to meet at such and such a time. Anyway, before we got off the phone, he said to me, "Are you a Muslim?" And I was like, "No." And he said, "But your name is Tahir. How?" Or back then, because we didn't have like Ta and Ta, right? So it was like, "Your name is Tahir. How are you not a Muslim?" And I was like, "Well, that's what my parents named me. I'm not interested in Islam." And I really wanted to shut that door. I was used to like Jehovah's Witnesses knocking on the door. I don't think the Mormons had started coming around yet, but I was not into, I did not want to talk about religion. And I think that that's like a common American thing as well. Like, that's not a door that you open. So I told him, I said, "Look, I don't want to talk about religion." So he said, "That's okay." He said, "Do you like to read?" I said, "Of course I like to read." So he said, "All right, when I see you, I'm going to give you a book and then we'll take it from there." Anyway, I guess we met within a week. It wasn't a long time. We met, And he had a book, I don't remember the name of it right now. I think it was something like Understanding Islam or something like that. And it was not long. I would say it was about 50 pages. It was colorful. It had some pictures. It was printed by the Saudi embassy in Washington, D.C., from what I remember. I began to read this book. As a matter of fact, I think I read it in one sitting. And I was pleasantly surprised because my idea of religion at the time was Christianity. You know, I had read a bit about Christianity. I read about the Trinity. That never made sense to me. But Islam, that basic message of there being a creator, that the creator deserves to be worshipped, he deserves to be thanked and worshipped, and that he sent messengers to mankind to teach them the path that leads to his pleasure, that was something that made sense to me. And I'm not going to say that I agreed with everything 100% right away, but I also didn't disagree with it. There was nothing that was repulsive about it, which I couldn't say for certain other religions that I had read about, or ways of life, if you will, because not everything was a religion, but sometimes there are just certain ways of life that I would read about, and I just couldn't get down with it. But Islam, it made sense to me. Another thing that I enjoyed about this book, I can remember reading about Salat, that concept of a personal connection to the Creator. And that's something that I felt was always missing in the social justice circles. You know, when you look at the political activists, a lot of times, and especially back then, so we're talking about the early 90s, late 80s, when you look at social activists, it's all about what's going on somewhere else. So I'm a young kid. I wasn't even 9 years old when I learned about Robert's Rules of Order, how to chair a meeting, learned about apartheid in South Africa, the Contra Affair in Nicaragua, and you know, things that were going on around the world. So you talk about social justice, we are looking at racial equality and so on. But a lot of times there's nothing about you. What is it that purifies your soul? What is it that brings you true happiness? And so I think that was something that resonated with me about Islam, that there was this thing that made me think about me. Who am I? Where do I fit into this big scheme of things that are going on? And I saw the pictures of Hajj. It kind of reminded me of the story of Malcolm X when he went on Hajj and how it changed his life. So there were a lot of emotions and a lot of thoughts as well that were inspired by me just simply reading this book. After that, the brother contacted me, I don't know, within a few days, we probably saw each other, and he says to me, "So what did you think about the book?" And I told him, I said it was okay. I didn't want to tell him how interested I was because I still didn't want to talk about religion. I wasn't ready to do that yet. But at the same time, you know, I did want to let him know that I was feeling comfortable about what I was reading. This process went on for about 2 months. This was maybe October of 1993. By December, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had opened my heart. And I was ready to accept Islam, and I did. I accepted Islam December 13th, I think it was, 1993. You know, alhamdulillah, I think that a lot of people who come to Islam, they have that first spurt. Even the Prophet ﷺ said, "لِكُلِّ عَمَلٍ شِرَّةٍ وَلِكُلِّ شِرَّةٍ فَتَرَةٍ." For every action, there's a period of enthusiasm, and then there's some downtime. Right, I didn't experience like this period, like immediately as soon as I became a Muslim, of being overzealous. In fact, when I first became Muslim, I didn't even know you had to pray five times a day. You know, I thought that was something that Arab Muslims did because, you know, their culture. I didn't think I didn't really consider that to be a religious thing. I knew we had to pray as Muslims, but I didn't understand that we had to pray five times a day. I knew you had to make Jummah. I didn't have anyone directly teaching me when I first became Muslim. And I would say that this process lasted. I read a lot about, you know, different aspects of Islam. But I would say that this process lasted for probably 6 months. And so we're into the summer now of 1994, the end of the school year. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me to meet some young brothers who were practicing Islam. These brothers were practicing Islam. You know, they were praying five times a day. And the one of the brothers, I would say he was my first introduction to the concept of seeking knowledge. So there was a young brother named Hamid, and we had all heard, like, you know, the younger Muslims, we had all heard that at Martin Luther King Jr. High School in Philadelphia, that they had established Jumu'ah at the high school, that the Muslims there were afforded the opportunity every Jumu'ah to gather and pray, and they had a, you know, khatib and everything like that. And so that was just like an amazing thing. This brother Hamid was the student organizer of that effort to have Jumu'ah at the school. And so I met this brother, I guess it was in June, late June of 1994. And there were a number of other brothers there. I would say at least 10 to 12, all in the late teens, early 20 range. And so there was an immediate attraction to that. Just the fact that, wait a minute, there's a lot to learn about this religion that I don't know. And I don't want to be a part of anything that I don't know about. And so, you know, I would say that that was where the period of zealousness came in. And not that it wasn't tampered, but I would say I was unnecessarily, you know, strict about a lot of things, just because I honestly didn't know and I wanted to err on the side of caution. The other good thing that happened that same summer was that three of my friends that lived on the same block as I did at the time, they all accepted Islam. So that was another push. And there was a masjid that was recently opened approximately, what, three blocks away from where I was living. So I got to frequent the masjid a lot more. And I think that solidified my journey as a beginning Muslim. You know, I think that every new Muslim has that phase that they go through where they're either going to stay firm or they're going to fall to the wayside. And it doesn't mean they're going to leave Islam, but they're going to hit a plateau and they're not going to learn a lot, and they're going to basically stay where they are and practice the way that they've learned up until that point. I think that this was one of the things Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me with, was that many of the people around me were Muslim at this point. You know, the people who I chose as friends, and also people who were with me from, you know, from before, but they accepted Islam. And so we started frequenting the masjid, and there were people there who taught us a lot more about our religion and took us somewhat of a systematic steps to learning Islam, learning about the articles of faith and so on. Philly has a lot of Muslims, and even at that time had a lot of Muslims. And there were Muslims who had studied even back in the 70s. There were brothers who left Philadelphia, went to Saudi Arabia, Mecca primarily, but some of them came to Medina as well, who had studied Islam. And so that concept now of going abroad to study Islam was not a foreign concept to us. And that's not something, I mean, as we know, even Khatib al-Baghdadi has that book called Ar-Rihla fi Talab al-Ilm, right? Which is to go abroad to travel to seek knowledge. So there were also other brothers who went to different parts of the Muslim world, Egypt, Yemen, Jordan even, in search of knowledge. By this time, by 1995, you had a number of brothers who had graduated from the Islamic University of Medina, or who at least attended some years, and then went back to America, and they were calling people to Islam and giving classes, and their lectures were being taped and things like this. We're talking about tape back then, by the way, cassette tapes, because that was the way knowledge was spread back then. We didn't have the ability to go on. There was no YouTube or anything like that. So, you know, there were certain brothers who had the plugs. This brother from Philly is plugged into this brother from New York and this one from Washington, D.C., and we would get these tapes. We used to get tapes, even some brothers that would go to Hajj, they would bring back tapes and mass produce them. And so the idea of going abroad to study was something that kind of took root in my heart. And I said, if I get that opportunity, I would definitely want to go learn Arabic. But that was the extent of it. I didn't want to spend a whole lot of my life, you know, studying Islam. I figured that if I studied Arabic, then I could just, you know, read the books myself and I'd be good. Okay, so basically, I finished high school in 1995. I got a scholarship to Temple University. So I studied 3 semesters at Temple University. In that first semester, when I was at Temple, one of my teachers who taught me from the beginning, like I said, after that 6 month period, this was December of 1995. He said, "There's a delegation from Saudi. They're in Fairfax at the IIASA. Basically, you know, the Mahad, they called it back then, the Institute in Fairfax." He said, "Look, they've come to Fairfax and they're doing interviews for the Islamic University in Medina. We need to go down and, you know, you can get your interview." And I was like, "Alhamdulillah, okay." So I skipped school the next day. We got in my car. I think it was at least 3 of us. We rode down. We did the interviews there in Fairfax. And I remember Dr. Muhammad Afifi, who interviewed me, he asked me at the time, he said, "Okay, so what are you doing right now?" I said, "I'm studying at Temple University. I'm a math major," so on and so forth. He said, "If you get accepted to the Islamic University of Medina, would you leave Temple University and come to Medina?" I said, "Absolutely." So alhamdulillah, what happened was about 7 months later, I think it was July of 96, I got word that I was accepted to the Islamic University of Medina. And so that was the beginning of my journey. Yeah, so basically once I got word that I was accepted to the university, I was actually in the summer semester at the time. And yeah, I would say that was life-changing. I was married. I had one child, alhamdulillah, that was born in May, like just 2 months prior. And I was living on my own. I just bought a car like the week before. And I got that information. I was like, subhanAllah, it's time to change. I got to change. I got to make a life change. I wrote a letter to Temple University asking them to defer my scholarship. I told them that I was going abroad. I wanted to study language, the foreign language, and that I would be back in a year. You know, so I wanted to take 2 semesters off, defer my scholarship. And that was basically, for me, that was like something that I could fall back on. To say, look, if I don't like it when I go over there, I've always got something to fall back on. I went through the process, all the paperwork, the medical exams and so forth. And I came with my family in September of 1996. My first impression of Saudi Arabia was that I don't think I can make it here because the heat is unbearable. I honestly remember landing in Jeddah, and you have to get off the plane to get on a bus, as you know, to ride to the terminal. When they open that door, it feels like somebody has a hair dryer, like a blow dryer, you know, on your face. And I'm saying, subhanAllah, what's going on? I didn't know that there was a heat that existed like that. And I remember that first day that I landed, and there were 2 guys fighting over a parking spot in the shade. And I thought of that hadith on the day when there is no shade except for the shade of Allah. You know, really, because those are not things that I'm thinking about, you know, in Philadelphia. In any event, finally made it to Medina. And I could tell you, and that this would be something I would think is more specific for Tulab al-Ilm, for those brothers who need to hear about what it means to have patience. Back then, when I first came, like I said, in 96, nobody had telephones. I mean, obviously nobody had cell phones. That didn't exist until later here. But even in your home, you know, having a telephone was not standard. So there was no connection to the outside world. When you come here, you buckle down. All you think about is what you came here for. And that is honestly, that's one of the ideas behind a rihla. That you actually go out to seek knowledge, that you travel, that you go abroad, right? Because the reality is that when you are abroad, the things that would normally distract you when you're in your residence and you're in your comfort zone, those things are not there anymore. So you have to focus on the goal and keep your eyes on the prize. You came here to learn Arabic. You came here to learn about Islam. You came here to memorize Quran. It's time to buckle down. That's it. There's nothing else to do. It was very difficult. When I got here, there were a total of, including me and the brothers that came at the same time that I came, there were a total of 12 Americans. So of course we all knew each other. I don't think there were many more British if they even had the same number. So it was like it was kind of like a Western thing, like the Western people, we all knew each other. Our wives had a very difficult time, to say the least, because again, there's no connection to the outside world. And we're going out, at least we're going out every day, either going to the Language Institute or those brothers who were in college at the time going to college. But the sisters weren't afforded that opportunity. They didn't have an institute for the women just yet. That didn't come until maybe 98, something like that. But back in 96, there was nothing. So it was difficult. And I would just say, man, as a man, as a husband, it was rough, you know, watching my wife go through those changes and trying to balance that with going to school 5 hours a day. And school was very different. I'm thinking the Islamic University of Medina. I'm thinking Temple University, right, just juxtaposed in Medina, where I have a 15 credit hours at the most or something like that. Now, you're going to school for 5 hours a day. You're sitting in desks that were made for middle school students. You literally, the air conditioner is so loud that you can barely hear the teacher. If they turn off the air conditioner, everybody's going to die. Because it's 120 degrees outside. So for me, just adjusting to living conditions, it took a lot, man. It took a lot. It was not easy. I will say that, and that's an understatement. But at the same time, we came in September, and Ramadan was like December that year. And so there wasn't a long time. Ramadan was beautiful, man. SubhanAllah. Experiencing a Ramadan in the Muslim world for the first time. Just that tahajjud in the Prophet's Masjid, breaking fast in the Prophet's Masjid. It was an amazing experience. And I will say that, as Musa said to his people, "Tastabdiluna alladhi huwa adna billadhi huwa khair." And are you going to turn in that which is better for that which is worse? When I considered everything, when I took everything into consideration, I recognized that Medina was such a blessing, man. Along with the hardships. But there is a reward for being patient with those hardships. And I think that is a conclusion that every student that is going to make it here eventually comes to. Is that, yes, there's a reward for being patient with this. Yeah, we're going to go through some rough times. And it was like that. It was financially difficult. Like I said, it was difficult for my family and a lot of other difficulties. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, at the end of the day, He didn't burden us with anything that we couldn't bear. And alhamdulillah, I made it through that first year. And that was the critical year. That was the critical year. After that, things got easier from a standpoint of conditioning. Now I know what I'm getting into. I had no idea what I was getting into from the beginning. But after that, it became clear, and then I was able to reset. I remember clearly in 97, that first year, we went back the first summer. I remember where I was. I was driving, and I was in Philadelphia, and we were back for about 10 days. And I hadn't heard the adhan for 10 days, man, called out loud, you know, other than Jummah. But you start getting used to certain things. In Medina, you hear the adhan 5 times a day. It's very easy to get to the masjid, so you're praying in congregation. You're always seeing other Muslims. The lifestyle is very conducive to being a Muslim. Get back to Philly. Again, Philly had a lot of Muslims. That wasn't the issue. It's just the life was different. And I remember we were stopped at a red light, and it was about 10 days back. We both were eager to get back to see our parents and so on. And it was 10 days in, and we looked at each other at the red light, and we said, it's time to go. Like, in other words, it's time to go back to Medina. And we still had, you know, another 2 months of summer to spend in Philadelphia. So after that first year, I did another year in the Ma'had, and then they had back then what they call Musul Khamis, the fifth level, so I did that. So I finished the Ma'had in 1999, started the College of Hadith, studied in Hadith for 4 years, graduated from there in 2003. From there, I did a graduate diploma in Dawah, which I finished in 2004, I started the Master's in Aqidah. The Master's program in Aqidah at that time was you do 1 year of coursework, and then they give you 3 years for your risala or your thesis. So I started the Master's in 2004. And I finished in 2008, but I didn't do the defense until 2009. After that, 2008, I started teaching at Taiba University. So when I finished the master's, I actually took a year off. And I started my doctorate, the testing for the doctorate in 2010, but the actual coursework didn't start until 2011. And now I'm waiting for my defense of the PhD. Look, Akhi, let me say this. I think that every person who studies in this university, the University of Medina, or if you ask a Muslim in general, what are your aspirations for the future? My aspiration is Jannah. And I know that that might sound like a bit esoteric and a bit far, you know, like, oh, well, you know. But when we talk about goals that we set for ourselves, You have to look at what is your end game and then work backwards, right? Because how do you get to that goal? Your goal in the future is to do A, B, C, and D. Well, you need to set certain things in motion that are going to get you to that point. And so that is honestly what I work back from. I want to get to Jannah. Our Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam said, "Man saraka tariqan yaltamisu fihi ilman sahala Allahu lahu bihi tariqan ila al-jannah." Yani whoever travels upon a path seeking knowledge in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make easy for him. By way of that knowledge will make easy for him a path to a Jannah. So honestly, a PhD means nothing to me. It means that I have more of a responsibility to continue studying because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed me to see how much I don't know. And so my aspiration is to continue studying this deen in a more systematic fashion than I did in the beginning of my studies. So I'm a lot more aware now of how to study, what I should be studying. And that's something that I just want to continue to do until I die, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. I also think about the hadith of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, where he said that when a child of Adam dies, that all of his actions are cut off except for three. A waladun salihun yad'u lah, yani a righteous child that makes dua for him. Sadaqatun jariyah, yani that perpetual charity. And ilmun nafi'un yuntafa'u bihi, knowledge that people benefit from. And you know, I'd like to have stock in each one of those three companies. I am doing my best by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's leave to raise my children to be righteous, and I hope that is a aspiration of mine, that I have righteous children and that they make dua for me. In terms of sadaqatun jariyah, or that perpetual charity, it is my future aspiration to develop a system of oqaf in the United States of America, or endowments, trusts, foundations, if you will, charitable foundations, but those that are based on not a system of tabarru'at or a system of charitable giving only, but something that we have a solid investment and that the charity grows by itself. I try to assess where we are as American Muslims, what it is that we need to be doing, what direction we need to be going into. And obviously there's things ideologically, but from a financial standpoint, I think that for generations now, or for decades, I can say, we've been surviving on a donor-based system. And so a lot of the masajid are supported by the charity of the people who attend the masjid. Living in the Muslim world, you see that there's a different way to do that. And you also study the history of Islam, and you see that primarily the masajid were supported by endowments. Somebody started a waqf, whether it was purchasing commercial property or residential properties, and then taking the benefits of those properties and using them to cover the expenses of the masjid. But I also want to expand that concept and create endowments for ilm.
يعني for educational projects. And that's something that, as you know, a lot of brothers in their latter years in the Jamia, you know, when they're about to graduate, they're always thinking, what's next? Where do I go? And it's not to say that they couldn't go somewhere and be an imam of a masjid and make a reasonable salary. But a lot of times that's not even dignified, because a lot of the masajid have been founded by people who have not acculturated to America. And so their concept of an imam is somebody that's at the masjid 5 times a day, 7 days a week, just a total workhorse. But then on top of that, yani, and on top of caring for the Muslims who come to the masjid and their children and the people who have problems, you know, whether it's marital issues or otherwise, they are also required to do outreach and interfaith and. So he's working 80 to 100 hours a week, and the salary is not anywhere near what he could get even working a minimum wage job somewhere. And so, and that's a shame. And so it is my idea that we take these endowments that I'm, you know, that I hope to be a part of establishing, and use them to fund educational initiatives, to fund research, to pay for the salaries of teachers who are working at the Islamic schools who are underpaid, and so on and so forth. That's in terms of ilmun yuntafa'u bih, or knowledge that people benefit from. And that would be the typical answer that most people would expect from somebody graduating from the Islamic University of Medina. There's no doubt that I want to take an academic path, whether that is teaching people, and I feel like that's a duty of mine. That is zakatul ilm. You know, that is the zakat of the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you with, however little it may be, that you give back. And so I definitely want to teach in a systematic fashion, such that a person can really get a good understanding of Islam without spending the minimal amount of time possible, meaning they're studying the right things the right way, bi'idhnillahi ta'ala. And so I do want to develop those kind of curricula, if you will, that will help Muslims to understand their religion better, to have some izzah, yani to have real, to be honored to be Muslims, to be proud to be Muslims, and to recognize that this way of life is the way of life that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decreed for His servants. So in terms of academic pursuits, yani there is the creation of institutes and infrastructure that will support this systemization of knowledge, if that's a real word, and as well as some ideas that I have for books that I'd like to do and other forms of getting the knowledge of Islam out to the people. Let me wrap it up by saying this, man. You know, I came into this deen at the age of, like you said, 15, 16, as a baby, and spent 21 years in the city of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam up until now. And alhamdulillah, I've learned so much. One of the main things that I've learned is that there's a lot more to learn. But I'll say this, I see a trend happening in America based on my study of Christianity. This liberalizing of American Islam, or what they want to say is progressive interpretation of Islam. And this is very dangerous and opens up doors that people couldn't imagine. And when we call for a reinterpretation of Islam, and that is an interpretation that is different from the way that the Prophet ﷺ taught his companions and the way that they taught the tabi'een and so on and so forth, then you're opening up the door for extremists. And you don't even realize it, because what's happening is people go extreme to the left and they go extreme to the right. So just the same way you have people who want a progressive interpretation of hijab, such that you have some people that say that even a bikini is hijab because it covers the private area. That is a reinterpretation of what the private area is, because it's not covering what is awra in Islam. But the same way you have that interpretation, which you could say is ultra liberal, if you give them the license to reinterpret, Why can't you give this same license to groups like ISIS and Al-Qaeda and all these other ones who are reinterpreting the text and twisting them to make them mean what they want it to mean, which is totally against the classic interpretation of Islam? This is a dangerous call, and we have to, as Muslims who have some sense of what it is that Islam requires of us, we have to be very active in educating our people to the beauty of Islam as is, without any of these reinterpretations, and to have some pride in our deen and to learn more about Islam. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase us in knowledge. Rabbi zidni ilma.